U.S. lawmakers racing to reach a deal on billions of dollars in aid to Ukraine and Israel before the holiday break. More in this report.
As snow blankets Ukraine, and Ukrainian troops brace for another hard winter of fighting, aid crucial to Ukraine's fight against Russian aggression is in jeopardy in the U.S. Congress.
For weeks, long weeks, a handful of Republicans have dangerously tried to link Ukraine aid and make our support for democracy in the West a pivotal issue that history will remember us for, conditional on passing hard right border policies.
The White House has requested $106 billion in national security funding, including $60 billion for Ukraine and nearly $14 billion in aid for Israel. While most Senate Republicans support that aid, they are asking for billions in funding for border security in return.
I called the president last week to make sure he understood that there wouldn't be a bill without a credible effort to get on top of our disastrous southern border situation. I hope that made the point, because I think on our side, I've been the most enthusiastic supporter of the underlying bill.
Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky said passage of the aid package in the U.S. Congress is one of three key victories Ukraine needs on the international front.
It's a challenge. It's not easy.
But U.S. lawmakers have only a few weeks left in the session before heading home for the holidays. And the White House says the aid already distributed to Ukraine is running dangerously low.
We didn't just pull those figures out of thin air. It was very much in keeping with what our partners have told us they need for the coming months. And in both cases, the runway keeps getting shorter and shorter.
Many Republicans have expressed concern about continued aid while there are many pressing domestic needs. One analyst told VOA the debate over Ukraine aid can't be separated from domestic political concerns.
Some of the critics of Ukraine aid would say, well, Ukraine is important, or Ukraine's in trouble, but we have a lot of domestic needs. We have poverty, we have border issues, we have other national issues, and so we should be spending the money on that. And I think that's a false dichotomy. A great country can do two things, or more than two things, at the same time.
Opposition to aid to Ukraine is more significant in the Republican-majority U.S. House of Representatives. But Speaker of the House Mike Johnson has said he is confident it will pass. Catherine Gibson, VOA News.
The World Health Organization warns more people could die from diseases than from bombings in the Gaza Strip if its health system is not repaired. During a UN briefing in Geneva, the WHO raised concerns about the outbreaks of infectious diseases in Gaza. A spokesperson from the UN Children's Agency in Gaza also reported cases of children suffering from war wounds and gastroenteritis.
The threats to children are very much from the air and now very much on the ground. He was terrified as a medical professional in terms of the disease outbreak that is lurking here and how that will devastate children who are immune systems and lack of food already is making them perilously weak.
11 other hostages, including 9 Israelis and 2 Thai nationals, were freed by Hamas on the 5th day of the temporary ceasefire. Soon after, Israel released 30 Palestinian prisoners. Once confirmed, the total number of hostages released by Hamas since Friday would stand at 60 or 81, including 60 Israelis and 21 foreigners. Israel, meanwhile, has released over 100 Palestinian prisoners. More hostages and prisoners are expected to be released Wednesday, the last day of the extended truce. With a truce set to expire, Palestine's envoy to the United Nations calls on the international community to help push for a permanent ceasefire to the war. Ambassador Riyad Mansour says a truce allows sincere efforts to address the humanitarian crisis in Gaza. More than 15,000 Palestinians have been killed in Israel's bombardment of Gaza, with more bodies feared buried under the rubble. Over a million more have lost their homes.
The massacres of Palestinian children, women, and men cannot resume, should not resume, you should not allow it to resume. The human conscience cannot bear it. International law, including humanitarian and human rights law, prohibits it. International law, but also the norms of humanity, demand that we act to stop this war against innocent civilians and save human lives, that we act for humanitarian aid and access throughout the Gaza Strip, the return of those displaced without delay, the end of the siege and blockade, and that we act for accountability. Nothing can ever justify war crimes, crimes against humanity, and genocide.
Israel has vowed to resume its offensive once the ceasefire is over, but is also open to extending the truce by one day for every 10 more hostages released. The West defending itself against accusations of unfair handling of the wars in Gaza and Ukraine. Arab leaders have accused Western countries of having double standards in the conflicts, saying they failed to provide the same support to Gaza. But NATO chief Jens Stoltenberg says the situation in Gaza and Ukraine are different in so many ways.
So upholding international law, upholding humanitarian law is important regardless of the type of conflict. Then I think it's also important to recognize that the situation in Gaza and the situation in Ukraine is different in many ways. Ukraine never posed a threat to Russia. Ukraine never attacked Russia. The Russian invasion of Ukraine was an unprovoked invasion, full-scale invasion of another country.
Finland is closing its entire border with Russia for the next 2 weeks in a bid to halt the unusually large flow of asylum seekers into the Nordic region. Last week, Finland shut all but one of its border posts to travelers from Russia, keeping open only the northernmost crossing located in the Arctic. The government says this too would now close. Helsinki has been accusing Moscow of funneling people into the border in retaliation for its decision to increase defense cooperation with the United States, a charge the Kremlin denies. Finland infuriated Russia earlier this year when it joined NATO, ending decades of military non-alignment. The death toll from the floods that have devastated many parts of Kenya climbs to 120. The Interior Ministry says more than 69,000 households have been displaced. Kenya's president has pledged to release millions of dollars to the affected areas. Kenya and its Horn of Africa neighbors Somalia and Ethiopia are battling flash floods caused by torrential rains linked to the El Nino phenomenon. The floods are exacerbating the humanitarian crisis in the region just as it emerges from its worst drought in four decades. A biotech company proposes a bold response to growing crops amid the threat of climate change. Paris and Los Angeles-based Interstellar Labs has designed the next generation greenhouse for farming in a controlled environment. The 55-square-meter biopod was inspired by space technologies to offer a totally sealed production system controlled by AI. Now the company will be attending the COP28 summit in Dubai to drum up interest and seek investors. But its ambitions are not just earthbound. In collaboration with NASA, a version of the biopod will be ready for use on the moon by 2027. Now it could also go further out in the solar system, as NASA sets its sights on the eventual human exploration of Mars and beyond. Molly, the Philippines' lone elephant, has passed away. Molly, who spent most of her life in Manila Zoo, died Tuesday at an estimated age of 50 years old. According to the zoo's chief veterinarian, Molly died of congestive heart failure. A necropsy on her body also revealed she had nodules around her liver and a slightly inflamed kidney. Animal rights group PETA slams the city of Manila for giving Molly a life in isolation and for ignoring her lingering foot problems. The elephant was donated by the Sri Lankan government to the Philippines in the 1970s when she was only 3 years old.